want to start by thanking the Chicago Humanities Festival, Diana and the Spencer Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation, of which I am a member of what's called a research network, the Research Network on Youth and Participatory Politics, and the MacArthur Chicago team. It's a team of graduate students that I'm working with to kind of flesh out ideas, some of the ideas, in fact, that I'll be presenting today. And in particular, you'll see a name there, Marcus Board. Marcus is just an exceptional graduate student I work with who helped put together some of the slides and also some of the video I plan to show today. I'm going to try to talk us through a couple of concepts and hopefully have some interesting and vibrant discussion by the end of our hour together. I'm going to keep a close eye on the time because I want to make sure that we have at least 15 or 20 minutes to really kind of talk together. So there are three or four things I want to talk about. First is the impact of new media, and what I mean by new media, digital media, social sites like Facebook and Twitter. I want to talk a little bit about the impact of these sites and new media on politics. I also want to talk about something we're calling participatory culture and participatory politics, right? So I want us to think beyond just kind of the actions of online participation, right? Did you sign a petition online? To think about the normative structure that underlines or underlies how we engage with politics when we utilize new media. And I'll say a few things about that. And then I want to talk about what I think many of us have in mind when we think about new media and politics. We think about kind of the question of young people and digital equality. And I'll say a few words about kind of the ways in which this concept has evolved. We used to think about digital equality really specifically in terms of, do you have access to a computer? It's become much more complicated and something we want to keep our eye on. But finally, I want to say a little bit about political equality. Because I think when you're talking about marginalized young people from marginalized communities, and in particular African-American young people, the young people that I study and work with, I think we set our sights too short if we only focus on digital equality and don't think about political equality, because I think a lot of what we really care about kind of locates itself around alienation and political equality. So that's what I want to spend some time talking about also today. All right, very quickly, there are going to be three sources of data. Don't worry about it at all. It's really kind of frequencies and marginals. Three sources from nationally representative samples. The first is from the Black Youth Project, data that we took back in 2005. I don't actually think I'll even reference much of that today. The second is the Mobilization and Change Project, again, a nationally representative sample of young people. Ages 18 to 35 would be the data that would come from that. And then finally, the Youth and Participatory Politics Study from 2011. I just want to make sure that you see this, right? That you know that all the sources are nationally representative samples with over samples of African American and Latino youth so that we have more statistical power. Everybody with me still? Okay, fantastic. Finally, I just want to say, well, not finally, before I kind of get into the meat of the subject, but this is the team of researchers involved in the MacArthur Research Network on Youth and Participatory Politics. So the idea here is that you bring together a bunch of hopefully interesting people from different disciplines, some of them advocates outside the academy, and you get to think together for 3 years, in some cases 9 years together. And the idea supposedly is that you lead to some type of paradigm shift in people's thinking on the subject matter. Not sure we're there yet, but we're trying to get there. All right, so let's start here. I think it is undeniable, at least for me, that when we begin to think about how, in particular, young people engage in politics today, at the heart of much of that engagement is the use of new media. New media has kind of changed the way in which politics operates, in particular for young people. And it would be hard to talk about, for example, the mobilization of young voters in 2008, and we could add to that 2012 around the Obama campaign without also thinking about the ways in which his campaign in 2008 used Facebook, and in 2012 used Twitter. I think if we begin to think about kind of collective action and social mobilization, social movements, and the Arab Spring, and some people would call it Arab Winter now, that mobilization happened in part through the use of new media, through the use of the mobilization of people in Egypt, in this case, but also individuals in the United States in solidarity with those in Egypt. Again, in large part because of new media. If we think about Occupy Wall Street, the young people there, many of them I've had a chance, not many, some of whom I've had a chance to talk to, some of whom were actually former students who built programs, right, digital programs, so around communication. A lot of those young people would say that part of the ways in which they heard about the mobilization of Occupy Wall Street was not through traditional media sources, but largely through online sources. And the ways in which they kept up with what was happening with Occupy Wall Street, again, kind of utilized the affordances of new media. Right? Even more recently, I'm not sure how many people have heard of If They Gun Me Down campaign. Have you? If you have, raise your hand. That's fine. So around the killing of Michael Brown, who you see in the middle, a number of users on Twitter decided to kind of mount a campaign. And the idea was they wanted to kind of present two pictures. One was we could kind of argue are kind of largely upstanding pictures of them conforming to the expectations and standards of what we hold as success. Oftentimes it's graduation, so you see a lot of individuals graduating, or, for example, at the end down there, participation in the military. The other picture was one, we might say, of these young people in a more compromised state. In some cases, a bottle of alcohol. Other cases, some people would say kind of flashing gang signs. It's not clear that's what they're doing, but that's how it's read. And the campaign was all about kind of which picture would the media utilize, which picture would they use if they gunned me down on the street, right? And it was meant to speak to the criminalization of what we call kind of black bodies and young black people. If you remember when Trayvon Martin was killed, we heard very quickly about that there might be marijuana in his system. When we heard about Michael Brown being killed, there were questions about had he been smoking pot, and you know, we saw the video around the cigars in the store. And the idea here among these young people on Twitter was, in many cases, what the state will do, what the police will do to justify the killing of young people is they criminalize them. And so they wanted to be vocal about that process with this idea of if they gun me down. Okay. And again, finally, I guess, if we think about even the reach of new media, right? There was a time when, in fact, you could build a campaign, you could protest, and it was largely contained to your local area. In this issue, or this image, you see a young woman in Palestine, right, sending a message to those in Ferguson. So whatever you feel about the issue of Palestine, that's not the point. The point is the connection, the global connection between these young people, right? So the idea that new media has an impact on politics and the politics of young people and the politics of young people across the globe is, I think, something that would be hard to deny at this point. Now, in our own data, what we find is if you look at how young people are engaging new media, or how they're even engaging their friendship networks, it's largely facilitated by new media. That's not to say that you don't see your friend in the hallway at school, but we know that almost daily, right, significant numbers of young people are utilizing what we call friendship-driven activity. Sending posts, sharing links, right, sending messages, updates, or chatting online and using social network services to do that. If we updated this data, you would find that about 80% of young people say that they do those types of activities daily with friends. So part of this is I want to make sure that, one, we understand the importance of new media to politics, but also we understand the kind of connected nature of young people at this moment. And I'm sure if anybody has a grandchild, a child, a niece or a nephew, or you understand already that they're connected. There's another kind of group of activities that we call interest-driven activities. So friendship-driven activities is when I email or text a friend or a family member. Interest-driven activities are really meant to kind of think about the ways in which young people pursue their interests and hobbies online, right? So the first one is, did you participate in an online forum or group related to your interests? And all of these are activities that would kind of formulate or kind of center around this idea of interest-driven activity. Again, the point here is that a smaller percentage of young people are engaging in these acts, but significant numbers of young people are engaging in interest-driven activity. Right. So if you remember on the kind of the outline, I said I wanted to talk about participatory culture. Because one of the things that we're finding is that if we begin to think about the way in which young people are immersed in new media, it has changed kind of their normative understanding of how, in fact, one engages with the world and what you expect. In this quote from Henry Jenkins, who was a member of the Research Network, he suggests that cultures with relatively low barriers to artistic expression and civic engagement, strong support for creating and sharing creations, and some type of informal mentorship whereby experienced participants pass along knowledge to novices. The idea is that the everyday practice of participation in utilizing new media changes our expectations, or in particular, the expectations and participatory culture of young people, right? They expect lower barriers to communication and engagement. They expect, in fact, the idea of sharing, and in fact, we often worry that they're sharing too much. They expect a certain type of informal mentorship, and it's usually intergenerational, right? So they have a different way of engaging the world in a cultural sense. We want to suggest, however, that participatory culture translates also into a different way of engaging in politics that we're calling participatory politics. So participatory politics, we expect to be much more interactive. I share and you share. It's not a kind of one-to-many. If we think of kind of the broadcast media, I'm the news anchor and I tell you what's happening. With participatory politics, we are having more of a dialogue and it's more interactive. It's also peer-based. So again, instead of an authoritative figure telling you how to think about politics, you are engaging and interacting with your friendship network, remember friendship-driven activity, and together you're beginning to get a consciousness around politics that might in fact conform to what the authoritative voice says, but it also might be something very different. Participatory politics, it's not guided usually by a deference to elites or formal institutions. And in fact, in many cases, it's a mocking of elites and formal institutions. So where once the party, the political parties may have controlled the information that you heard about a candidate, you now hear information from the parties, but you also might see a video that mocks the candidate. And I could show you many of those, right? But there is a different way in which politics is regarded for this generation. And it's also meant to address issues of public concern, but not necessarily in the formal and many would say rigid ways in which young people or people interested in politics have engaged those things. And I'll explain that to you in a moment. But there's a kind of blending of the boundaries between what we might call popular culture and popular politics. Okay, so I think there are many benefits, we would argue, to an engagement of participatory politics. First is that we see young people circumventing traditional gatekeepers. There is a way in which they have an ability to kind of control the information, to share it with their networks, and again, not to defer to elites. They are allowed to kind of customize materials and information, which often makes that information actually much more interesting and relevant to the communities that they're trying to speak to. There is a greater reach to outer networks. There was a time, for example, if I wanted to mobilize you, I might put up a flyer and the people, you know, maybe I'd post it in a church or my school, and those were the individuals I could reach. The thing that we know from young people who are doing organizing now is that they can put it on any number of social media sites, and they not only mobilize the people in their communities, they mobilize their networks and their networks. So there's a kind of much bigger reach in terms of the possibility of having voice for young people. And again, they're pushing the boundaries of popular culture and politics. In many ways, sometimes what they're doing is they're initiating these conversations with their networks around friendship issues, and then introducing politics later. If you lead only with politics, you tend to have a much kind of a narrow group who are interested. If you lead with kind of your relationships, family and friends, and popular culture, then you can broaden the network, even though there might be some selection in terms of if people are interested. So let me give an example of that. How many of you ever heard of the Harry Potter Alliance? Yes, this is my favorite example. Okay. So the Harry Potter Alliance was started by Andrew Slack. It was really a fandom, right, a fan club around Harry Potter. You ever heard of Harry Potter? Yeah. Here you go. Nerds doing good deeds, nerd fighters lead to fan activism. So it started really as a fandom. And as they thought more and more about the fandom, they realized that if you were really kind of going to be consistent with what Harry Potter would have, or actually Dumbledore, you would be engaged in politics. And they started campaigns asking, what would Dumbledore do? And that sounds nice, right? Like, oh, that, isn't that sweet? But what emerged from that is pretty amazing. So they have almost 250,000 members. They have engaged in issues from gay marriage in California to, in this case, sending 5 cargo planes of relief aid to Haiti. They have muscle, right, as a political organization. But it was a political organization, I would define it as a political organization, they probably wouldn't. They would say that they were a fandom that at times engages in politics. And I think that's what we're seeing from young people. There's a reimagining of these boundaries, right? They don't want to only be confined to something we call the political realm. They want to be engaged in the world. And sometimes that's through popular culture that blends into politics, and sometimes it's politics that blends into popular culture. I think for those of us, for example, who study politics, I'm a political science, this is a significant reorientation because we look for politics in certain very predictable places. Right? And when we don't find that politics there, we say, these kids are just so apathetic. And I think what they're suggesting is you have to kind of reimagine. I remember kind of the early feminists, second wave feminists, saying the personal is political. In many ways, these young people are saying the personal and the popular are political. All right? So we could say, well, that's nice. Harry Potter Alliance, who really cares? It's 250,000 kids. But we wanted to show you something. I want to show you something else. Is that when we ask young people kind of the types of activities, political activities they're engaging in, we find that, 41% say that they're voting or intending to vote. These are the kids that aren't 18 who say, yes, I'm going to vote when I turn 18. About 44% are engaged in other political acts, but 41% are also engaging in what we're calling participatory politics. So these are not kind of, it's not 5% engaging in participatory politics. This is a major component of the political world of young people. So we have to pay attention to this. Now, there's, of course, a downside to participatory politics. I'm falling behind already. There are things that are, we would call weak ties. Malcolm Gladwell has written about the concern over weak ties, that what we're asking young people to do through new media is not really something that will lead to a social movement, he would argue, and the strong ties needed for a social movement. Instead, we're asking them to do kind of minimal or superficial things that create weak ties. I would suggest that in a political domain, you need people who are doing things that necessitate weak ties, and you need people who are doing things that necessitate strong ties. And so if this is the domain where people are engaging in weak ties, that's all right, because you use those weak ties to build into strong ties to do more costly things. The same way he would, other people would argue this is superficial engagement. People have talked about it and called it kind of slacktivism or clicktivism. And you know, the question is how costly is it, for example, to sign a petition? We consider that a political act. Young people think that, in fact, if I take lots of time and craft a funny video that makes fun of the do-nothing Congress, that that's also a political act. And in fact may reach many more people than the petition that you're handing around. So I want to be careful when we suggest that, in fact, this is just superficial engagement. People worry that, in fact, it will displace real politics, right? The 41% people would say, well, this is what's happening, that young people who would have voted, no longer voting, instead they're doing this kind of clicktivism thing. The research suggests, in fact, that's not true, that what generally happens is that it's often a pathway to things that we think of as more impactful. So young people who are voting are also engaging in participatory politics, and usually it's participatory politics that might be a step hold into the more traditional political domain. And then there's the concern about cementing offline inequalities. And this has been a big issue in the field of political science. The idea here is that those who find voice utilizing new media are the people who already had voice offline, right? And that what we should worry about is that the weak are getting weaker and the strong are getting stronger. It's just a new avenue for voice. And this is, I think, something we should really be concerned about, this idea of cementing offline inequalities. And here's, I want to talk a little bit about digital equality. So this, to me, is about the question of digital equality. There are many ways in which we've kind of conceptualized the idea of digital equality. Early on, we talked about access and the digital divide. I'm sure everyone has heard at some point the digital divide. And the digital divide was largely this question of, does everyone have access to the internet or the World Wide Web? And we should be concerned with that. I can tell you, and I'll show you, I think, data letter later, that every young person has access to the internet. They have it, it's differentially, right? And I'll talk about that in a minute. But people generally do have access. We're now starting to look at other things, like supports. To what degree is there someone who can help you think about what you do on the web and how you do it? So this becomes a new kind of dimension of digital equality. We want to know, do you have skills? Can you build or can you make the video that I've been talking about? Do you know how to disseminate that video, right? Do you know how to post it online? Can you edit someone else's blog or something of that sort? And then finally is the question of use. In particular, there's been a big concern that somehow young people, in particular young people of color, are on the internet doing things that they shouldn't be doing, or that they're doing things that aren't very helpful, right? If we think about kind of social digital capital, they're not building their social digital capital. Instead, they're kind of watching Beyonce videos, right? And that, to me, could be useless. But let's talk about that in a minute, okay? So what do we know about access? Again, we know that everyone, almost all the young people we talk to, at least 95% or more, said that they have access to the internet. One of the interesting things here, very quickly, is that young whites, and I think Asians, I can't see from here, are more likely to have a desktop or a laptop, and young African Americans and Latinos are more likely to have a handheld device, like a smartphone and a gaming device. So they're all able to access the internet. They're accessing the internet differently. And I would say 5 years ago, I would have been very concerned about that difference, right? But with cell phone technology, I'm less concerned. What's really actually quite interesting, and maybe I should be concerned, is that when you talk to young people, and in particular young people of color, you find the things that they can do online with cell phones are amazing. I can't tell you how many of them told me that they wrote their term papers on their cell phones. I know, I felt the same way. But they didn't seem to worry about it, and their teachers didn't express concern. One of the places where we do see, again, a little bit of difference is in broadband access, right, and the speed question. So again, African American and Latinos are less likely to have access to broadband, but in fact, the numbers are going in the right direction. On the question of skills, Hergati from Northwestern tells us basically that African American and Latino young people have less knowledge about the internet. And this question of skills, there's a skills gap that we would want to pay attention to here. So access looks pretty good. Speed is going in the right direction. Skills is something that we should be concerned with. Very quickly, in terms of digital supports, do young people have supports to learn about digital issues? The majority of respondents tell us they've never had a class that taught how to make or share digital media. They've never been taught how to effectively share your perspectives on social and political issues online. They've never been encouraged to think about how people might feel when you comment online, right? And they've never been given advice on what to do when people criticize you online. So in terms of supports, and this, I'm gonna come back to this, right? Let's bracket it. But in terms of supports, we have some issues, right? And I will say this very quickly. I wanna talk about schools. I worry, in fact, that too many of our schools are so concerned about the use issue, what young people do with these cell phones, and that we shut down internet access. I can't tell you how many public schools and charter schools do not allow their kids to access the internet during the school day. My daughter goes to lab, very happy on some dimensions at lab. Since first grade, she's been in a programming class, right, teaching her how to program. and utilize. They don't shut down access there, right? So we really want to kind of interrogate and think about the privileges that we are allowing some kids to have and what this will mean in terms of accessing and being successful. Now, let's just talk really quickly about a couple other things. One of the things we know, even in terms of digital equality, in terms of use, that African-American young people are more likely to be engaged in friendship-driven activity. Okay, so they may not have the same skills, but they are in contact with each other. In terms of interest-driven activity, there are two slides here. Asian-American and African-American kids are more likely also to be engaged in interest-driven activity, and we just got new data that, in fact, confirms this and suggests that the gap may even be bigger. Okay, you can see it here. If we think about offline participatory politics, there's an interesting thing that happens. When we're talking about offline participatory politics, white young people are more likely to be engaged in those types of political actions, right? So took part in a protest, demonstration, or sit-in, participated in a boycott, or participated in a boycott. Now, online participatory politics, we find that African-American youth and Asian-American youth are more likely to be engaged in online participatory politics. Not a huge, huge gap, but there is a significant difference in terms of online participation for African-American youth. Right. But here's the thing. So we know, in fact, that participatory politics is important. I'm trying to watch my time here. We know that, in fact, young people are online and engaged. We know, in fact, that young African-Americans, in fact, seem to be, in many ways, more connected than other young people. But there's still a question that I think we have to struggle with, and it is this question of equality, political equality, and justice, right? Just because, in fact, you have equality doesn't, in fact, mean that there's a just situation. And here is where I want to talk a little bit about kind of political alienation. The one thing that we find is that young black people are more likely to express political alienation. So they're more likely to distrust the government. They're more likely to distrust the legal system. They are more likely to believe that they are considered to be second-class citizens. They are more likely to believe that they've been provided inferior education. We might say that they're astute. They're more likely to believe that they are likely to be mistreated by the police, and they are more likely to believe that they have been or will be discriminated against. When we ask them if you think racism is still a major problem in the country, and these, to me, these numbers are pretty striking. 32% of white youth say that racism is still a problem in the country, and almost 70% of African-American youth believe that racism is still a major problem in the country. And you see Latino youth coming somewhere in the middle, around 51%. So there is this issue of political alienation. There is, we might argue, more digital equality than we've had before, but there's still a significant role of political alienation. And the question, I think, becomes why? We've had this interesting, I think, contradiction that, in fact, more access to information provided through new media in many ways has exacerbated or extended the political alienation that young African Americans face. And I want to show you this video. It's about 5 minutes, and parts of it are disturbing. I'm going to tell you that right now. But I want you to understand the images and the ideas and the events that young people, and in particular young African Americans, are dealing with every day that explain, in fact, why I think they believe themselves to be second-class citizens and why we see the level of political alienation that we do.
You do that, all right. I'm not the operation in this vehicle.
Are you gonna open the door?
What are you saying? Somebody's not gonna hurt you. People are getting shot by the police. Ah! Oh,
damn!
Ah!
Ah! Ah! Oh,
yeah. And then they say police brutality. Arrest her.
Stop. Oh, he is beating her up, yo.
Oh my gosh, why?
Is that a cop?
I'm minding my business, officer. I'm minding my business. Please just leave me alone. I told you the last time. Please just leave me alone.
Once again, police beating up on people.
Back up
right here.
Back up and get on that step.
Okay.
Back up.
Sir, what's going on?
Gunshots in the store. 90 corner. Police officers are here. They're on the scene.
All right.
I've had any shots fired. Started the ambulance.
All right. So it is this question, I think, of political equality that should grab us and make us move forward. I totally agree that we have to be concerned with digital equality. I want every young person to be able to have the skills and the supports and the access to be able to utilize new media and the web in ways that will fully empower them. But I think if we don't understand the political alienation that is intersecting with new media at this moment, we will miss an opportunity to, in fact, engage in something and to create something that, in fact, is meaningful in changing the lives of young people. Now, let me explain what we mean by political equality, right? So first, the concern with digital equality is important, but it's not enough. That equality even in participatory politics is not enough, right? But that the affordances of new media, right, may in fact actually heighten the political alienation that we're finding and seeing among young African Americans. So we have to start thinking about political equality and the public sphere in a kind of digital age, I would argue. Hannah Arendt has often argued that equality is not an attribute of an individual. It's not what an individual has or what an individual does. Of course, we want to be concerned with some levels of equality in that sense, right? We want everyone to have equal access to an education. But in terms of political equality, we're thinking of something different, right? That political equality is really kind of the equality of interactions that take place amongst individuals within a space as they interact with their peers, right? I guess the thing I want to pose for us is, are we creating spaces that facilitate the types of peer interaction that produce something we might call political equality, where individuals can engage in discussions and dialogue meant to kind of think through the issues that are most important to their lives and to be actionable, right? Are we producing dialogue and debates as equals who are connected in a shared project of betterment, right? Because in fact, to me, digital equality takes us part of the way, but kind of the interaction between digital equality and political equality in a public sphere is actually what's really going to change many of the images that you just saw a moment ago. And here we're talking about the creation of what we might call a new black public sphere. That the black public sphere we know was in fact a critical space of connection and reflection. So there's the Habermasian understanding of the public sphere, and then there are kind of counter public spheres where in fact communities of people who are largely kind of banned from the traditional public sphere have an opportunity to discuss their condition and to kind of make strategies and plans that are actionable to kind of change their condition, right? And that was so central in terms of thinking about the black public sphere for a very long time. The black public sphere was central to mobilization in black communities and central to something we might call the civil rights movement or the black power movement or whatever movement that you want to focus on. And many have argued, like my colleague Michael Dawson, that integration and economic disasters have undermined the black public sphere as it traditionally functioned. And so the question becomes, is it possible that the affordances of new media allow us to craft spaces of equality for marginal subjects that in many ways function as a new black public sphere, in particular focusing on young people, right? Might the Black Youth Project, The Root, The Griot, Huffington Post, Black Voices begin to serve as those spaces of dialogue and debate for political peers, right? Thinking about a project of betterment. So we have to start thinking about what is the infrastructure that can promote that. So I'm going to start with schools. Schools won't work. Okay, not true. Schools might work, but they can't work alone, right? My colleague Joseph Kahn and Ellen Middaugh have already found that, in fact, in schools, civic advantage and service learning and political opportunities are largely given to already advantaged students, to white students, students of the upper class, students who are the best students get these opportunities. But in many ways, the young people that we most fundamentally need to engage are often left out of these opportunities when we only place an infrastructure around creating these spaces in schools. So we have to think, I would argue, beyond schools. And like any good organizer would tell you, you meet people where they are, and where are young people? They're online. So we have to think about ways we can provide support for meaningful engagement online. Doesn't mean that we have to go in heavy-handed and say, this is what you're going to do now, but it means how do we craft spaces that in fact look like the places young people want to go, that provide them with use and skill and access and the opportunity to be full human beings and to kind of respect their insights and understanding of their own lived experience and produce something that, in fact, we might take serious. Now, online, a kind of new online black public sphere might look something like the Black Youth Project. And I'm highlighting the Black Youth Project because I started the Black Youth Project. Doesn't mean it's very good. I think it's pretty good. But it's an example. It's not what we should be doing necessarily, unless someone wants to write me a check right now. So we're online. It's a digital space focused, for example, on African-American youth. We have three components. The first one is research. We start with research and produce research on young black people by young black people. We promote the idea of voice. We have a website where, in fact, young black people work as bloggers and writers, and we're actually trying to do more original content, right? So we believe in voice. You have to have knowledge, voice, and then, of course, you have to have action. And towards action, we've created a new organization called the BYP 100. We were lucky enough to get a grant from the Open Society, and we convened 100 young black activists from across the country, and they started an organization called the BYP 100. Let me very quickly show you this video, and then we're almost finished.
I am 6,935 days old. I am 19.
The Black Youth Project is really cool because it's a space where people from various communities can come together and get information.
Finally, there's a place on the web where young black people can speak for themselves.
My words, numbers.
It's the bridging of the gap between academic tools, and so youth can learn about the data sets that are out there about us.
You can get information from the rap lyrics database.
You can find a whole number of videos as well as articles and blogs that talk about hip-hop in a way that respects young black people.
It is a place where the perspectives of young black people will be heard loud and clear.
Too often we hear of the extremes, either those that have made it or really the millions of young people who are incarcerated, who find themselves in failing schools.
I'm sorry to say, your best friend is gone. Now you know why I don't pick up the phone.
And we can actually talk about things that matter to us.
A lot of youth have something to say now. We understand now and we want our voices heard now.
And at the forefront of every civil rights movement, every war, every story that your grandmother spoke words and told, there is a remnant of educated young black activists screaming to ears that have yet to be listened to.
Hi, my name is Lee.
Edward James.
Jonathan Likes.
I'm Summer.
My name is Justin.
My name is Camille.
It's Alexandra Moffat-Bateau.
Hi, I'm Cathy Cohen.
I'm 19 years old.
I'm 19.
24 years old.
I am 17 years old.
I am a blogger.
I am a blogger.
The principal investigator.
I'm a poet.
That's all you need to know.
When I was one day old, my voice began to beat out into a cry. I would not be silent. I will be heard.
Let me just quickly finish and say, I'll explain this slide some other time. These are the 100 young people that we convene. But I do think that there's a moment that we have, right? We know that young people are immersed in this new media. We know that, in fact, they have a clear sense of the conditions that they face, in particular young black people. And they are kind of crying out, I would argue, for support. Not necessarily leadership, support, right? And we have an opportunity, I think, to build an infrastructure that can kind of lift up their voices and provide them with opportunities to lead around the issues that concern them most fundamentally. We can do some of that in schools, and we can focus on digital equality, but I want to suggest, in fact, that the new framework we really have to think about is political equality. What does new media mean, not just for the practice of politics, but the equality of politics for this generation? And I think, in fact, if we move forward and provide the right supports, we'll be amazed at what's happening. We need only look at kind of the mobilization around Ferguson that happened by this combination of alienation, new media, and politics. So thank you very much.
We'll take this time now for questions. Hold your hands up in case I don't get to you, so that way I can get to you when we're going on to the next question. So we'll start off over here.
How long ago did you have this Black Youth Project? When were the 100 together?
Right.
And then I wanted to ask, I mean, yes. If it's long enough to have seen any results when they go back to their communities, are they still in touch and saying what might have happened?
Sure. So the convening happened in 2012, actually. So just a couple years, no, was it 2012 or 2013? I think it's, we just celebrated 2013, I think, sorry. And out of that convening is actually a pretty incredible moment. We happened to be convening on the weekend where the George Zimmerman verdict was announced. And it was incredibly powerful. For me, I say this all the time, it was saddening to see another generation of young black people kind of come to the realization that in many ways, they didn't feel like full citizens. They hadn't seen justice. I remember Rodney King, we could talk about Emmett Till, right there, these kind of almost generational moments. But out of that, I would argue, sorrow, they decided, in fact, that they would build a national organization. They now have chapters in Chicago, New York, D.C., Philly, the Bay Area, and they're building one in New Orleans. They are a membership of over 200. They have had lots of media attention, for good and for worse. And they're doing amazing things. In Chicago, they have mounted a campaign around kind of minor possession of marijuana tickets and actually arrests. The whole campaign is around the fact that the city spends $80 million a year on minor arrests around marijuana. And their analysis is what could happen in their communities with that $80 million, right? If I go back to this slide very quickly, this is about just, for example, the Black Youth Project and other projects, though. This is an analysis from Ethan Zuckerman of the kind of critical nodes of information that led to the story of Trayvon Martin actually taking off. And what's incredible to us is you might see, over here it says the Black Youth Project, right? That these small spaces focused on issues that concern young people of color actually can be critical in a major story like the Trayvon Martin story. And so I think this group, the BYP 100, is doing incredible work in all of these cities. Nationally, we're trying to make sure that, in fact, we keep attention to the concerns of young Black people and now young Latinos also. So I think, again, we can see the possibility of building this type of infrastructure that is largely led by young people focused on the issues that are most of concern to them.
Question about privacy, because obviously all this stuff is online.
Absolutely.
And what's the current dialogue that's happening in this area so that, you know, what's going on with privacy isn't stifling people talking, but at the same time being aware of what's being collected?
Right. I mean, I think this goes back to this question, I would argue, a larger question about media literacy. And we've been pretty amazed in our research. The recognition among young people that they need some kind of, they need teaching and supports in this area, whether it's privacy or just kind of how to assess the quality of research, right? What's a reliable source? I mean, in our first study, our first survey, 84% of young people said that they really kind of long for help in trying to kind of think through what's quality, what's an issue, and how do I respond to these things. Privacy is going to continue to be a big issue, and one of the things that we talk repeatedly with young people about. Do you understand the kind of the legacy of the archive that you're building? Something that seems kind of minor and insignificant, a kind of silly picture with someone, if we go back to the, you know, if they gun me down, right? If you put that picture up, this is what it allows people to interpret you as. So that becomes a part of it, but I guess I want to suggest that that's a larger question about media literacy. But we also have to figure out ways to kind of not just, we want to prepare young people to think about these issues, but we also want to facilitate their voice, right? I don't want to set up a situation where what I tell a young person shuts down their voice. I, in fact, want to empower their voice in ways that make a difference in their lives. And I think that's what we're asking for, is a kind of broader framework here in thinking about even the question of media literacy. How do we kind of reconceptualize what media literacy is? Instead of one of fear, but one of empowerment. What is it that young people need to be empowered? So I don't know if that helps.
To what extent have you found
where are you? Tell me.
I'm sorry?
There you are. Okay.
You can stand up. To what extent have you found that your students are using their media literacy to urge schools of education and other formal institutions, even just universities, to develop the supports they need so that they can use their literacy, media literacy, more effectively? I'm thinking as a teacher, there's nothing more powerful than a student capturing an inappropriate teacher on their cell phone and putting it online.
Yes.
It's how we learn how powerful our students can be, and yet many of them don't have the tools from within school to develop the skills you're talking about.
Right. So I think that's a very important question and a very important intervention that I hadn't, kind of schools of education, I hadn't thought about as one of the places where we really need to be thinking about how are they teaching teachers to talk about media literacy and teach about media literacy. One of the things that we've been, I want to be careful what I say here, we've been working with the Chicago Public Schools on their Global Citizen Initiative, which is really kind of their civics for largely seniors. It's actually wonderful program. But I've been shocked by how many of the teachers don't really feel comfortable thinking about new media. So when they built that curriculum, there was no new media component to it, none. And we are in the process of introducing about 5 segments, and with the hope, we're working in partnership with a really wonderful new director, Jessica Marshall, and we're gonna kind of build out the whole new media component. But it was not, when they thought about civics, it was not about incorporating what happens online. So that's one thing. Second, though, is that a lot of the teachers don't have the skills to teach what happens online, right? And they will say, I don't know which websites to go to. I don't know how to teach media literacy. I'm an English teacher. I mean, this is the nature of public schools also. I'm an English teacher that got told by my principal I need to teach the civics course, or I volunteered because I have an interest in civics, but I don't necessarily have a lot of professional development or support to do that work. Now, again, that's because in many schools, we don't value civics as something, in fact, we think is critical to what we teach young people. My colleague Joe Kahn just had a really wonderful op-ed about preparing kids not only for college and careers, but also for what he calls community, and that's what they're doing in Oakland. How do you become an active member of your community? How do you change your community? And part of that has to be learning some of the things that we've been talking about here. So I think that there's a lot of work to do, not only, and I guess I would argue, not only with students, and I think many, this is what's funny, many of the teachers, almost all, to a teacher, they will tell you, my students know more about new media than I do, and I think that's scary, right? It's scary to introduce a subject, I can say that as a professor, where you know all the people in the room know more than you, right? So the strategy often is just not to talk about that, right? But that's unacceptable. And so we have to figure out, again, where are the points of intervention? I think you raise a very important one, schools of education. Yeah.
We have time for about 2 more questions.
I know you talked about the political participation, and
yes,
that remains low for our young people. Why are we not able to engage them in civic duty as elections? Though I know with the election of President Obama, a lot more enthusiastic,
yes,
the first time around, but not so. When I looked at my household itself with 2 young children, second time they did not seem as enthusiastic.
Right.
So, and now the midterms are here and the participation is going to be very low. Mm-hmm. And I think that is really sad that our young people who should be more engaged are not as much.
That's a great question. I probably have the wrong answer. I'm not sure that our Congress deserves enthusiasm or participation, right? I mean, it might be actually quite rational to decide that when I look at the 2 candidates who, in fact, mostly tell us negative ads, right, and what the other person doesn't do and hasn't given us a clear sense of what a future might really look like, that I would be disengaged from that process. And so I guess I would say part of the, people would say apathy among young people has to do with our political culture and the candidates that we're running. I think, in fact, when we see candidates that make young people excited, as we did in 2008, and I would argue even in 2012, young people show up at the polls. In 2008, for example, African-American youth voted at a higher rate than we had ever seen any group of young people vote, right? So we know that if given the right candidate, they will show up at the polls. They showed up again, actually, in 2012 also. Now, not all young people, but in particular African-American youth showed up again in 2012. So I do think that, one, if we're only looking at voting, we have to look at kind of the political culture that we're asking people, young people, to engage in. But two, I think, again, we don't want to only look at voting. And this is, you know, if we had more time, we could have a real, I think, interesting debate. If I'm watching The Daily Show, or I'm watching political videos online, and I'm becoming informed, and I do things that don't look like traditional politics, is that still politics? And I guess I would say if we broaden that lens, then we begin to see young people engaging in politics in a way that we hadn't imagined, and we see more of them engaging in politics. Now, I think there's a real conversation to be had, and we have it on the research network, about is that significant or impactful or important? Because in the end, what we want is we want young people to be able to engage in a politics that changes their lives. Making fun of a candidate may not change your life. You may become even more informed. So you have to figure out how do we then take the bridge, build a bridge from that type of information and engagement to something that looks more meaningful. And I think that's what we're trying to figure out now. So I don't want to write them off. I would kind of, I'm disparaging about our political culture, but I think we could do better. And I think if we do better, young people will become more engaged.
Yeah. We are just about out of time, but we've got one last question.
I'm curious of your thoughts about a very different kind of participatory politics,
Okay. Which
is, for example, and I don't know exactly how this could happen, but it's basically a technological expansion of community organizing. Like some leadership emerges and says, hey, we've got the technology, we've got the price points to create a sentinel effect on the police because they have to wear a camera on their uniform. Mm-hmm. How could such a movement take hold?
Well, I think it is already taking hold. I mean, I think across the country, you're watching police departments decide or be forced, we have to decide, you know, figure out what we think is really going on, to include body cams. And I think this is a classic example of what we've seen from Ferguson, right? That there was a movement that was in part built because young people kind of spread the word on new media. I mean, people, there have been any number of articles written about what happened on Twitter versus what happened on Facebook. But many people watched Ferguson unfold, not on CNN, but on their Twitter, right? And I think it's been that type of movement, that type of pushback, sometimes in Ferguson, but often outside of Ferguson, that has kind of really made police departments and even the federal government to the point that the Attorney General ends up going to Ferguson, that has really kind of created a movement that led to this kind of, we would argue, win. Some people would argue when, right? That now, in fact, police departments and major police departments around the country are deciding, in fact, that they have to figure out ways to have their officers become at least more accountable or figure out ways so that they can determine what's really going on in these interactions. So for me, I think this is another example of the ways in which new media works to kind of, I won't say contain the decision-making of a major institution, but clearly influence it. And I'll give you another very quick example, which is in the New York Times, they were writing up a piece on Michael Brown. I don't know if how many people read this. And they said at one point, he was no angel, right? And there was just outrage, largely on this entity called Black Twitter, right? Because we know that, in fact, Blacks disproportionately participate on Twitter. To the point that, in fact, the New York Times apologized for calling, saying to him he was no angel. Now, many of us who deal with teenagers know I have yet to meet a teenager that is an angel. So, but to watch major entities like news organizations or police departments begin to incorporate what they're hearing not only from on the ground but from online mobilizations, I think, again, speaks to what can happen online if we take this seriously and if we provide young people with the skills necessary to be, we might argue, online organizers. And I think they're figuring it out, even if we're not moving fast enough. Okay, so I think that's it. Thank you so much.